and welcome to another episode of Don't Shit on the Bus. I am your host, Adam Omakayas, tuning in all the way from Los Angeles, California. And this week we are on episode number 57. Hey, that's pretty good. That's almost 60 and that's more than 50 and we're over a year. Wow, that's solid. Thanks everybody for the support. Thanks for sticking around. This week we have the electric, the amazing, the awesome Katie Robinson, VP of Marketing, all the way over at Electra Records. They are a subsidiary of Warner Music Group, and they've got a bunch of labels underneath them. And if you don't know what that means, that's fine. That's what this episode is here to do today for you. That is what this episode's purpose is. It's kind of like, what does a label do 101? So, you know, Katie works in marketing at the label, but she herself has been in this industry for almost 20 years and just knows everything there is to know about labels. She's worked very small labels, indie labels, climbed her way up to a major, and now has a pretty significant role at a label. And she just has a very vast amount of knowledge to share with us. I don't know how many times I've used vast in these intros, but it's probably a lot. Anyway, I liked this conversation. I was really happy that Katie was down to have it with me. Thank you so much, Katie, for taking time out of your day, you know, last day before labels kind of go on break for the year, and talking with me for an hour, because I really appreciate it. And in a way, like, we are way under Katie's pay grade, right? For her to do labels 101 is kind of like, all right, let me just tell you what I know all this stuff. This is really easy for me. But that's what I want to get. I want to get, like, the most professional person from that area to break it down for us. And Katie is even better because I've known her for a long time. She's a great person. She surrounds herself with great people. If you were here last week, you know Melissa is friends with her. And I learned a lot. So today we're going to talk about, like, what does a label do? How do they do it? Why do they do it? What's their purpose? Because I'm sure everybody has heard, oh, I'm signing to a label. Oh, I have a record deal. What the heck does that mean? You know, they put out their music. What do they do? What goes on behind those doors? And then more practically, how can you work at a label, if that makes sense for you? Because I think the theme of this podcast, I'm pretty sure the theme of this podcast is, all right, where are you at? Where are you trying to go? And how can I help you get there? So hopefully today we can help you get into the music industry a little bit. Work at a label. Hit up Katie. Say, let me intern for you. Now, you don't have to hit up Katie. Just don't say I sent you or something. No, I'm just kidding. Sorry, Katie. But really, all right, cool. Well, before we get into the episode, as usual, thank you so much to our patrons. Patreon.com/DOSOTB or don'tshitonthebus.com for some information. These are the people that pay our wonderful producer, Connor, fund our wonderful writer, Ava, and help me put food on the table. No, but really, you make this podcast possible. Thank you so much. We've got three new patrons, Nathan, Jocelyn, and Jacob. I appreciate you. Thank you so much for supporting the podcast. A little bit goes a long way for me here, and I hope that this episode helps you on your journey to not shitting on the bus. Hey, get on the bus. Welcome to the podcast, Katie. How are you doing?
Hi, I'm doing good, Adam. How are you?
I'm good. Thank you so much for taking time out of the last official label work day, music industry work day, to speak to me.
Of course. Yeah, it's hard to believe we're at the end of 2021 now, but here we are. It's been a crazy few years, but yeah, happy to be here.
I do not know how it's 2022 already.
Me neither. It's definitely, we're already, you know, starting to plan and talk about things for like 2023 and 2024. So it's just, we've all been in a time warp, but we're getting through.
Yeah, we're in the 20s. Is that kind of weird to say? You know, we're in the 20s, like 1920s, yeah. But we're in the 20s.
It's, yeah, in my mind, it's still 2019. I'm sure a lot of people are.
Yeah, I if it wasn't for the podcast, I'd probably still be in 2019. So I relate. Yeah, but you know, we were talking a little bit beforehand, and you are going to do us the wonderful service of being our first person on the podcast from a label. So thank you awesome. For coming on here. And you know, correct me if I'm wrong, but your job title is VP of Marketing at Electra, right?
That's correct. Yeah. Vice President of Marketing for Electra Music Group and for projects that are across, you know, all of our labels that we work with. And yeah, I've been back in the Electra system since 2019, actually started back in May of 2019. So yeah.
I'm excited to learn about, I mean, you said Electra system, you said it very casually, but I'm excited to learn about all these labels and subsidiaries. I think I'm using the right words eventually in this episode, because that confuses me so much. But for anybody who's listening, Katie's job specifically, she's the VP of marketing, but today she is going to kind of talk to us about not only how she got into the industry, but what labels do on a very broad level, because if you're a listener, we haven't really talked about any of this before. So it's an important, you know, it's going to be like labels 101 almost. And you've been in this label world for longer than I've been in the music industry at all. Do you think we could kind of go back to where you started and just walk us through it? Because I tried to do a little research and all I've got is an email with you from 2009 when you were at Atlantic and we were working on Mayday Parade like that. So I got that point in your career. But other than that, I've just seen you at concerts throughout the year. So where did you start your journey in the music industry? Like what? And it might be before your first job, honestly.
Absolutely. Yeah. I started my journey in the music business. I guess it started back when I fell in love with just going to shows and just fell in love with live music overall. I started out by going to, I grew up in Tennessee, mainly Tennessee and Louisiana. Okay, cool. And I was living in Memphis in high school, and I started going to shows, like hardcore shows, punk shows, and just really got into that scene. And that's sort of where it all started for me. Started working with my friends there who were, you know, promoting all the local shows. And I kind of learned about how that all works. We would go to shows all the time. My friends and I would like pile into the van and go to whatever the closest festival was, or we'd drive to like, being in Memphis, we would go to like Nashville or Chicago or Atlanta, or, you know, wherever the shows were, we would just like get in the car and drive and go and then head back. So that's really where it all started for me was, and I think that's been something that's really driven my whole career too, is just that understanding of what it truly means to, I guess, just like be part of that scene or part of a movement with other people, and just how much power that has in someone's life. That's where it all started for me. And so I was in Memphis, and I was actually going to college at University of Memphis for music business. But just kind of felt like if I wanted to, because my whole career, I've always wanted to do marketing at a record label, whether that was with majors or indies. So it's always been my goal. So to be able to do it is something I'm very grateful for after all this time.
Congrats. That's cool. That's just cool to hear that you really wanted to do that. And now you're the vice president of it at, you know, a pretty prominent label. So well done.
Thank you. I moved out of Memphis and moved to Chicago. This would have been in 2003 or 2004, and went to Columbia College for music business, same thing. And I was pretty much doing anything I could do, however I could be involved. If I was like, you know, wheat pasting flyers on telephone poles for shows, or like I did a zine for a while, worked for whatever local independent labels there were, whatever shows there were. But I was also on street teams for a lot of different labels at the time. And one of those labels I was on a street team for was Victory Records, which was based out of Chicago. So that's while I was in college, I started interning there. And that's where my journey with, you know, with labels started, was with Victory Records in Chicago back in 2004, I believe, and was interning there, and then got the opportunity to be a marketing assistant. Like, kind of got my foot in the door that way and just never looked back and just kept going there. And that was at a really cool time for that label when it was Thursday and Taking Back Sunday and Hawthorne Heights and Silverstein and Trey, like all these bands who were really, blowing up at the time. So it was a really cool experience for my first label job. Was there for a few years and then got the opportunity to move to New York and start to work at Atlantic Records in 2006. Oh, wow. Yeah. So I made the jump from Chicago to New York and went from indie to major. Yeah. So it was a big jump to go from, you know, obviously the indie system in Chicago to, you know, moving to New York, and jumped right into, I had this amazing opportunity to assist the head of marketing at Atlantic at the time, Olivia Tortella, who's an incredible marketer and so creative and just super passionate. So I really had the opportunity to learn from like her, and Julie Greenwald had just come over to Atlantic at the time. And just to get to see, you know, really an incredible team was such an amazing learning experience. And from there, transitioned into marketing. And that was at the time when Fueled by Ramen was also moving up from Tampa to New York to work with the Atlantic system as well. So I just jumped right into, you know, with my roots in the Victory in the indie world, that would, you know, just made a lot of sense for me to just jump right in there. And yeah, so I did all the Fueled by Ramen marketing for a few years up until 2013, and then moved to LA to work at Interscope and do marketing there. So jumped from one major to another major, and then ended up back in the Electra system, you know, in 2019, which was great, because the Electra system, I say system, but You know, our label, we're a sister label with Atlantic underneath the Warner Music Group umbrella. So, you know, it's a lot of the same artists I used to work with and same team members I used to work with back when I was in New York. So, so it's a great homecoming, and the past few years have been just incredible and a really great time through all this madness. So that's sort of the broad strokes of my journey, a little mix of, you know, being in the indie world, and major world, and yeah, I've been doing it now for 16, 17 years now. So,
hey, well done. I was trying to take, if you saw me looking away, I was taking notes. I wasn't like, but, cause there was
it's
a lot
cool
said.
Too.
Yeah. No, I would never, I was going to jump back and say when you just wanted to relate, but when you said you're with Victory in 2004, I'm from Madison, Wisconsin, and I was street teaming under Mark Bubb at that time. So kind of similar, but yeah, there we go. he's amazing. So it's crazy how much, what blew my mind is how many different labels you've worked at and how many times your job has changed. And I know that that's pretty normal in the industry. You know, people go around, they do a different jobs, but how did you navigate this as far as, I mean, every time you switch a job, you're kind of quitting a place, I guess, in a way, maybe that's the wrong word, but how do you, and I mean, obviously you're not severing these relationships. How did you navigate the industry? Are these people just excited when you kind of level up, or what was it like going from Victory to, I forget the timeline, Victory to Atlantic and everything.
Yeah.
Was it just, all right, this is my next step? Or what did that feel like being in that position?
Yeah, absolutely. I think the best advice I was given early on in my career was to never burn bridges with people, because this is such a relationship-based industry, specifically at labels. I mean, it's such a small, small world. And whether it's getting your foot in the door, just starting out, or if it's, you know, getting a call about, hey, there's this opportunity to come to this company, or, you know, it truly is all based on relationships and who you know. And so that was really good advice I was given very early on, was, you know, never burn bridges, because you never know, like someone you hire one day could end up being your boss a couple years down the road, or you never know where an opportunity is going to come from. Yeah. So I think it's just maintaining those relationships. And, you know, at the end of the day, we're all, I think, especially through, you know, COVID and quarantine and seeing what touring industry and everything else has gone through the past few years, it's definitely an industry of where we're all there for each other in a very real way, which I think is very unique to the music industry as well. You know, there's people I've worked with my entire career who I've known forever, people who I'm, you know, just now getting to know. And of course, you know, really talented, passionate people who are just starting at labels and just starting in the industry. So yeah, I think it's one thing that sets working at a record label, working in music in general apart, is just people. It's definitely a people business.
Yeah. And I like that you, through learning about your journey, we know that you've kind of been through every step of the process. You know, you were the street team, you were the fan, then you were at the indie label, and you've seen all these different people that now, although you're probably, well, you are a lot higher up in kind of the food chain, or for lack of a better word, you know, there's a lot of people that you probably work with that you see yourself in, or your past self. And that probably makes it, you know, a lot easier to relate to them.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And it's, I think it's, if someone is like just trying to get in or trying to figure out, like, how do I start a career at a label or at a business? It's a lot of just getting to know people and reaching out, or even if it's like blind messaging or emailing someone and just being like, hey, can I talk to you for 5 minutes? You know, that goes a long way, I think. And people remember that. So I think it's making that human connection too, because at the end of the day, that's what's going to keep your opportunities coming in throughout the career.
Yeah, that makes sense. And like I told you before this, we started the podcast, it was mostly about touring. And with touring, it's primarily word of mouth. I was wondering, when you were going through all these jobs, at the beginning, did you submit a job application? And then from there, it was kind of like, here are my credentials, hire me or not. Is that kind of how it worked? Or did you ever have to submit a job application again?
That's a really good question, actually. Yeah, every opportunity that I've gotten, even going back to, you know, when I started my career, has been through people I've known or through relationships, or So, I mean, I have had to, you know, put in job applications online and things like that. But
yeah,
but all these jobs that I've just talked about, you know, that I've been at for years and everything else came in through, you know, people I knew, and through relationships. But I've also, you know, I've interviewed for jobs at other places that ended up, you know, not panning out, or sometimes opportunities don't work out for whatever reason. So it's, I'm probably making it sound like it's been like super easy, but,
we're doing the highlight reel.
That's part of it too. Absolutely. Yeah. That's part of it too. When you're, you know, getting into this business as well, as trial and error, and sometimes things don't work out for, you know, whatever reason. And that's just because that wasn't meant to be. And you're, you know, going down a different path. But yeah, it's definitely, I've been through the process formally at things, and then also just gotten phone calls or texts and been like, hey, what's up with you? Like, let's talk. And yeah, things kind of go from there.
It's nice to hear that from somebody as successful as you, because I think a good amount of people I talk to are just getting into this industry. When they get told no or something, they often feel maybe alone, or like they're the exception to the rule, or like this is not something that happens. But to hear people who are successful, let them know, you know, I was told no a lot, or I didn't get a lot of these jobs. It's normal. It's fine. And, you know, you can still be successful.
It's all part of the process. And even if it is someone going on an interview or taking a meeting or whatever it is, mm-hmm. if that ends up not resulting in a job, it's still such good experience, because you've put yourself out there, you've made a new connection, and who knows, this connection that you've made, even if it wasn't for right now, maybe, you know, that's someone that's in your network now. Yeah. So it's definitely a process. And if you hit closed doors, because we all do in this business, you know, no matter which side of it you're on, you know, rejection is part of it. So just my advice is just keep going, like just keep going, keep trying. And what's meant to find you will find you.
And how do you handle when you get rejected or closed doors, or however you want to word it? How do you mm-hmm. handle that relationship in general with that person to secure it in a positive way, rather than leaving them with a bad taste in their mouth? Because I feel like that's an important kind of point to touch on.
Definitely. Yeah. I think that all comes back to, you know, just a respect and just saying, you know, gratitude, and just no matter what happens, just saying, hey, thank you so much for mm-hmm. your time. Thank you for the opportunity. Look forward to seeing you again soon, you know, and just, it's a respect thing. And a lot of times if something doesn't work out, or you think you're going to get a job and it ends up, you know, you don't get the job or whatever, there's so many different factors that can go into that. It's so hard not to take something like that personally, you know, especially if you are on the creative side or you're a musician or a writer, you know, it's hard not to take that personally. But yeah, but a lot of times it is, there's so many bigger things at play and bigger things at work.
Yeah, no, that's a good point. You don't want to think like this was my fault, when, hey, maybe somebody else just came along that they had to hire, some other situation. It might not just be you did a bad interview or you weren't fit for the job or something.
Exactly. Exactly. Just keep at it. And what's meant to work out will work out eventually.
If people listen to this podcast at like 8 a.m., it's like with a coffee, they're going to be stoked for the day so far. They're gonna be like, oh my God, I can do this. I just got to email people. Like, we've just been almost amazing. Like, we're just like a hype. We're so far, it's just been like hype. Like, this is how you do it. Just keep going.
Yes.
And I hope that hits some people.
Little PMA for the morning, but yeah.
I know, right?
Yeah. That's a big part of it. And like, also just like lean on your friends, lean on the people that are in this industry too, that know what it's like. And yeah, guarantee that you're not the only person who's feeling that way right now if it's something that didn't work out. So one other thing as well, when it comes to career choices and, you know, different paths that you go down, is, you know, sometimes you do try new things as well. After being from Atlantic and then Interscope, you know, I went to Red Bull Records, which was a really exciting opportunity for me, because that was getting a glimpse into what a record label was like, operating very much as, you know, very much in the indie spirit, but within this massive company, which was a really awesome experience and such a good learning experience, and got to work with some really amazing bands and build out a great team there. So, but yeah, that was a different route for me, was trying something a little bit new in the brand world that was still music focused. So yeah, sometimes in your career also you try new things, or try something that might be a little bit outside of your wheelhouse too. And that's, making that leap is important, I think, to stay creative and to stay passionate, and, you know, getting to meet all new people and work with all new different artists.
And it's nice too. I'm sure all your friends supported you and, you know, helped you out, and all these people you've known throughout the industry. And, you know, another example of that, guys, is Katie here right now. I am not a podcaster my whole life. This is something I'm trying. And she was nice enough to come on here. So you can see that people, even on her level, are, you know, still helping other people out. So,
absolutely.
And you guys, yeah. So that's awesome. I never thought of that Red Bull was operating under kind of like an indie label guys with, you know, major, major, major label funding, but they're still trying to build it up. So that's, yeah, that must've been cool.
Yes, exactly.
All right. Well, that will segue us very nicely in. I think we know a good amount about how you got here, and I want to talk with you about labels in general. And I kind of typed out, I was like, where do we start? But I think the best place to start is, most people know about record labels. They're the things I get mad at, or the things I get stoked with, or, you know, they're the company that creates or puts out the music. But what is a record label? Maybe very like just a definition of it. And then moving forward, what is the goal of a record label, is where we should start. And if you think we should start somewhere else, let me know. But that's where it came to in my head.
I would say the definition of a record label whether it's an indie or a major or, you know, someone who's like in their basement cracking vinyl. It's just what a record label is, and the ultimate goal of a record label is to grow artists and to get that artist's music into the hands of as many people as possible. You know, it doesn't matter what, you know, what genre it is or the size of the label. It's, you know, a group of people who are working together to just get the music out there because they believe in it and they're passionate about it. And, you know, it's that team of people too, who knows how to connect the dots. You know, in the major label structure, it's, you know, you have all the different departments and you could have, you know, 50, 100, 200 employees who are all working together, but very broad strokes across that. It's, you know, an artist being able to tap into this group of people who are all, you know, super experienced and connected and passionate and can take that artist to the next level. So whether that's, you know, publicity team getting, you know, press and late night TVs or a sales and streaming team who's, you know, talking to Spotify and Apple Music and YouTube Music and all the other DSPs, you know, to get playlisting and to get streams ramped up.
DSP, we got to define it real fast.
There's a lot of jargon here. Digital service provider. So that pretty much encompasses any streaming. Yeah. Any streaming service that you listen to music on, which is a whole ecosystem inside itself, which is very fascinating to me. There's radio, who is obviously, you know, in all the various formats, a team of people getting, you know, getting those songs airplay, video department, who's, you know, creating videos and then getting the videos out to the world, you know, creative teams, people making artwork. So if I were an artist, I would envision it as like walking into the front door and going, okay, these are the people that are going to, here's the music I've made. Here's who I am as an artist. Let's get it out.
Teach everybody about this in the way that, you know, and the labels are using their experience and their resources. And they're kind of, you know, we had Mike Mowry on the other week who was talking about being a manager and all these different branches that they kind of manage. And one of them is the label. And the label sounds like, you know, they're the people with the funding. They're the people that can say, hey, you know, we know what size artist you are, but we can kind of take it, use our megaphone of money and resources and people that are going to be really big fans of yours and teach everybody about it. That's cool. I like hearing about it. You're just a bunch of hardcore music fans.
I mean, at the end of the day, every single person, I think if we didn't love music and we weren't all total nerds about it, we would not be sitting here.
Yes.
We all work way too hard for way too long to not love what we do, which I think is the coolest thing about this business, is we get to create and have fun, you know, doing what we do. We talk about that a lot at Electra Music Group too. And that's something we all very much believe in too, is let's have fun, you know, like let's do some cool stuff and put cool stuff out there. And not to say it's not hard, and some days it is not all fun and games, but yes, every single person I've worked with who's in the label system, like, just loves music. It's what we do. We live and breathe it. And we get to do it for our jobs, which is amazing.
Yeah, that is awesome. Yeah, if you're working at a label and you're in Los Angeles or Nashville or something, usually your job is like 9 to 5 and then 6 to wherever you're at the show. So these people love music. They don't just say it. You'll see them every concert you go to. They're just there. So I believe it.
Yes, I will say that was the biggest adjustment for me, and I'm sure a lot of other people who work in the industry during, you know, shutdown and quarantine, was not having the live music element or the, you know, because so much of our jobs are, you know, like I said, built on people. So it would be events or parties or awards or shows or, you know, so having that part of it go away, I think we really had to get creative and lean on each other to find that in different ways. But very grateful that there is live music that's back now in a safe way. And
yeah, it's kind of wild. I mean, I have a lot of relationships, like people that I know, such as you, that I'll see once in a while at a show. And that is the extent of how I've known them. And when you get rid of that, there was a lot of people that I just stopped knowing, but not on purpose. I just was like, oh, I just haven't seen them in a while. So I can't imagine what it's like from your point of view, where that is a huge part of your job in a way, is to go to these shows, meet other people, talk with them, and work together. You kind of, and it needs to happen organically. It's a hard thing to be like, all right, I'm going to meet up with all you guys on Zoom at 9 a.m. and organic conversation is going to happen. So
exactly. Yeah. Yeah. It was a big challenge, but it also makes you realize how much we appreciate that. And just the casual of, you know, I remember I ran into you at Self Help Fest a couple years ago. Like, oh, hey, what's up? And that was like a reconnection. And yeah, it's just how much you like, so much of it is based on just running into people and being like, oh yeah, seeing this person at a show or this person at a festival or whatever it may be.
Yeah. Well, I think that something that I've learned to respect more as I've gone from touring to more, I say working in your world, but I just mean, you know, working in music, not necessarily at the show, working more label or with management or on the back end of everything. I respect how good people are at remembering names and faces and communicating and keeping track of their network, because it used to just be, well, it's the five band dudes I'm with and then whoever we meet during the day. And you guys are like talking to hundreds of people a day, sending emails. And I'm like, wow, it's like, they're crazy, but in a good way. They really do love it because it's borderline masochistic, but you guys are like really good at what you do. It's awesome.
Thank you.
Yeah.
That's hilarious. That's so true. That I've never thought about that before, where it is like, you know, even if it's like, okay, this artist's album is coming out, like, who do I know at this company that I can, oh yeah, this person did it. And like, yeah, so that's Rain Man. Part of it.
You know what I'm saying? It's just like the things are just clicking. And I'm sure.
A lot of times I feel like when, especially when I'm like setting up the strategy for like a single launch, pre-order timing, album rollout, I feel like the Matt Damon from Good Will Hunting gif where he's just like trying, like writing out the formula. I'm like, that's a lot of it too. Sometimes it feels like we're doing really hard math.
Maybe that's the movie I meant to say, and I said Rain Man, and it was just the wrong one.
Same thing, I think. I think
okay,
it all applies.
Cool. Smart people. Yeah, I mean, you as a person, when you, do you get like a very good feeling of accomplishment, or what is that feeling when you like, you connect the dots or you make the thing happen? Do you know what I mean? Like, it just must be so fulfilling to be able to do that for people and like see it at a concert. I don't know.
That's the magic. That's the, I always call it, sound like Oprah, I call it the aha moment where I'm like,
yes.
Oh, wow. Like if that to me is the end game, is seeing this artist who you love so much that you've worked really hard with, like seeing that album or single or video go out into the world and seeing real humans react to it. And that, you know, oh, this video like made an impact on somebody's day, or maybe this video helped them discover more about this artist and then discover 10 other bands that they also love. So that to me is like the magic of all of it. When you can, you know, it's like, okay, we've worked for the past 6 months to a year on this campaign, every single minute detail, it's all come together, and then to see it out in the world. And for my role in marketing, you know, to talk a bit more about sort of the details of what I do, it's, you know, it's essentially creative direction, campaign management, strategy. And it's really putting all those pieces together, everything from what is the brand of this, you know, what is the brand of this artist? What is this album cycle? You know, a lot of artists we work with, it's even defining what, you know, what are the color schemes we're going to use? What are, you know, so all of those tiny details, if it's, you know, working on setting up the album cover photo shoot, all of those details come together. Then you see it laid out and you're like, okay. And then you see the cover, you come up with 10 more ideas. I'm going on a tangent here.
No, but it's great because we could tell this is exciting, and I like hearing about what people are excited about. So keep going. You can tangent away.
Absolutely. But yeah, building every single like building block of that campaign. And another big part of my job is taking all of those elements and delivering it, you know, to our team to say, you know, here's the, not only the song, but, you know, here's what just the whole aesthetic of the whole campaign, the whole point behind it. And when, you know, the stores turn over at, you know, 9 p.m. Pacific, midnight Eastern, and you see that product actually out there in the world, and then you start reading comments and you see what, you know, fans are saying online, and just seeing all that come together is truly the magic behind all of it. And seeing it at a show too, is, I'll never forget, obviously, this year and when live music started really coming back, but this year one of the artists I work with is 21 Pilots, and we put out Scaled and Icy, this year, which is, you know, Scaled and Icy, stood for Scaled Back and Isolated. And a lot of the album is about, you know, the whole rest of the world going away, and getting to see the first time I saw them perform those new songs live and walking into a room, you know, with an audience and with real people, and seeing, you know, the fonts that we used on the album cover and seeing the band perform it live and how all the production came together was just, it was really amazing. Cause I was like, I've been like,
you cried.
I have cried so much. This
I could tell you cried because of how you talk about it. I was like, oh, tears were shed.
Oh, I absolutely cried. I was just like, I was like, I've been in like a bubble here in this, my home office, like going through, like using my home printer to print out samples. And like, you know, I literally am looking at like prototypes of deluxe box sets and stuff right now, but to see it in the world again and be like, oh, okay, this is a real, like, it's real. We're doing it, was a big moment. And then get to see them live on the Takeover tour and get to see the different size venues every night.
Oh, how cool.
They played was like, just, I will never forget those moments. It was incredible to get to see that.
That's awesome. Well, I'm glad to hear about you know, the end goal and how it's rewarding and, you know, what you're working towards. But something you mentioned casually, which I want to go a little bit deeper into, is your team. And I'm sure the team changes depending on the size of the label. But just real quick, how many people work at an indie label generally?
I would say at an indie, probably, I mean, depending on, it could be five people, it could be, you know, 20 to 30, just sort of depends on the level and size of the indie, but I would say probably anywhere from like five to, I don't know, 20. And then at a major, you're probably looking at, I mean, somewhere probably from even like 75 to like 200, like depending on how big the, you know, how big the company is. But
in touring, kind of how it works is, you know, on a small level, it'll be like we have a tour manager and a sound guy and a guitar tech, right? And then that's where they start. And then as they scale, each of those jobs turns into like five different jobs. You know, it's like, okay, instead of a tour manager, we have a production manager and a stage manager and a front of house person because, you know, the jobs get more big. They become more difficult. You're in an indie label. What would you say the first five jobs are at an indie label, if that makes sense?
I would say an indie label structure is probably built most heavily on, that's a really good question. Depending on distribution setup, I think obviously step one, right, is making sure that the music can get either out digitally or in record stores. So probably built most on the distribution. And then, yeah, a lot of times, you know, indie structures that I've worked in, we, you know, you also hire out to, you know, like an independent publicist or, you know, we work with like an outside video commissioner to help get a video made. So I think it's probably built more most heavily on sales, marketing, distribution. So I would say if it was like, if you're looking at a staff of like three to five people, it's probably what you're looking at. That's a really good way to equate it to touring though, right? Because it's like... You could have like your friend who drives the van overnight or your car or whatever to get to the venue the next day. And then there's all the way to the level of like, oh, we have, like, I have my own bus and I stay in a four-star hotel every night and I have 40 people that work for me. So
I could kind of tell as you're saying it, we're telling like half truths, you know, cause it's so, I can tell that you know this so well that you're like, well, three to five people work there, but we have these other companies that we work. We can't answer that question. Like you didn't ask it totally right. And I get it. It's hard to break it down to a basic level when nothing's really that quite basic. It gets complicated so fast.
There's just so many different ways it could be set up. And I guess depending on genre, if it's like, you know, a small punk rock label versus like, you know, it's something, it's just, there's so many different ways that could be set up. But
and then as the label gets bigger or it becomes a major label, do those jobs kind of just have departments? I don't know. If you were to break up, let's say if you were to break up Elektra, I know there's a lot of like, well, we work with this label for this part, or maybe we outsource this. But if you could break it up into departments, what are the, from the outside looking in, is it A&R and then merchandise, or like, what is it? What is Elektra?
I think with any, you know, major system, you're going to be looking at, you know, obviously A&R is a huge system.
I can tell it's normal for you and unknown for like, if I don't know it, then I know nobody else has heard it before, but I can tell in your world, it's normal and I like it. So they're called systems because they're not just
labels. I say system, you should say like different structure, company, whatever, however you want to put it.
But
obviously A&R is, you know, A&R and research and, you know, the people who find the artists and find the songwriters and producers and talent. That's obviously, I think, the backbone of it. Because without A&R bringing in that talent, everybody else, you know, doesn't really have anything to work on. So that's sort of, I think, the portal into it. And then usually I'll say it for like once an artist gets signed, that's probably a good way to think of it. So you know, you work with A&R, you get signed, you make the music. And then from there, your team gets built out around you. My role as, you know, a marketing director and all the other, you know, marketers, and sometimes the title is product manager, which I like have a love-hate relationship with that title.
Product manager.
You get assigned your team. And, you know, a big part of my job is partnering with the artist and their manager to sort of be their quarterback within the entire company. So if one of my artists or managers, you know, those are my partners. And if they need something, you know, I'm the first phone call, whether it's, hey, we need to do this, or can you help us set up this meeting? Let's talk about finding a stylist, like whatever that might be. That first phone call is usually, you know, usually to us to get it done. And then we assign, you know, a digital marketer internally. And a lot of artists come in with their own teams already. If it's like they come in with their own publicists, or they already have their own creative director, or every project is kind of set up a little bit differently. But yeah, it's a publicist working with the sales team, eventually once we get to it, because there is a lot of, you know, and that's something I think people don't really understand about labels as much too, is that there's a big setup time, you know, and there is a big process to, you know, it's not like something, and, you know, but again, sometimes it does happen where we'll sign something and then we turn it around 2 days later and it's out. But a lot of the times, you know, it is that setup process and the planning and doing the photo shoots and that, you know, so it's a long process. And sometimes before things even get to the wider team at the company, just to make sure everything is like, you know, set and ready to go. But it all depends on the artist and kind of where they're at. But yeah, then everything just sort of gets plugged into there. And I think one of the most important things about a successful label too is the ability to pivot. And to be honest, if something isn't working or, you know, a song isn't reacting at radio like the way everyone thought it would, okay, what's plan B? And just having those honest conversations. And I think that's a really important part of a label too, is, you know, if everything's not an immediate overnight hit, which 99% of the time it isn't, is being able to pivot, you know. And a lot of times I've worked on projects too, where we'll try to go to the big, like, you know, pop radio machine or, you know, whatever that might be, and say, hey, we're not there yet. We're not ready. Like, let's keep building, keep developing, keep touring. So yeah, that's sort of a very broad strokes. I hope that all made sense.
Oh, I'm all ears. I thought it was great. I mean, it was interesting to me when you said that, you know, artists come to you guys, like, let's say whatever artist comes to you and wants to sign with your label. And then do you guys adjust your setup based on how they're built? Or are you like, no, you have to do it our way? Or I guess, who's in charge? Do you work for them? You know, is it just a collaboration? Are you working together on the same team? Or are they kind of calling the shots and you're doing the thing? Like, what's the relationship usually?
I think it's, you know, some artists need the help of the team a little bit more when it comes to certain things. And then others, you know, walk through the front door and are like ready to go. And they're delivering us like, here's the album artwork, here's everything.
Yeah.
And then it's up to us to take and run with it. So we really adapt our approach and strategy and team and all of that based on what the artist needs and what their setup is. Because at the end of the day, this is, you know, this is this person's career, this is their life, this is their art and their vision. So we really work with them to find what fits best for what they need right then at that moment. So it kind of varies, yeah, depending on where the artist is at and what they need. But at the end of the day, it is listening to the artist. And I've never found it to be essentially super healthy or productive if it's, you know, if it is the team saying, no, you have to do it like this. And you got to do what works. You got to listen to people and you got to all work together to find, you know, something that works. So I think that is a really cool part of the label side of it and the strategy as well is, when you get to turn around and say, okay, so this artist has this already, or, hey, we really need help in this area, and being able to focus that all back together.
I want to do an escape room with only people that work at labels. Because I feel like they'd be really good at it. They're just like problem solving and can work as a team. And they're like, oh, let's crush this.
That's just a terrifying thought. I hope there's a bar.
You said what?
I hope there's a bar.
Yeah. Well, that would be necessary too. If you want everybody. No, I'm just kidding. Yeah. That's
hilarious. Be like, okay. So you have a baby artist who's just signed. Well, that's really funny. Let's do it.
You guys should that should be your company trips, or, you know, I'll just come observe. I would just, sometimes they'll have like cameras where you can watch everybody in the escape room, and I'll just be like, oh, look what Katie just did. All right. Yeah. Interesting.
You know, it would be really funny too. It's, you know, who would be the best at like an escape room or a survival room is touring crew and like a TM, like the person who's in charge of running like sponsorships for the festival, like plug those people in a room and they'll be like, oh, they get out in like 2 minutes.
Okay. Well, I will tell you, I'm pretty nerdy. I like escape rooms. I've done a few of them. I took a band I was on tour with once to an escape room. It was me, the full band, and their video guy. And it was an absolute disaster.
It was in an escape room. They would be like,
yo, TM. Yeah. It was like, it was so funny. And I had to kind of, you know, sometimes in those situations, you just have to like kind of take a back seat and be like, all right, I'm just going to let this happen because you can't, you know, I was like, all right, but it was pretty funny. But yeah, being with the touring crew, they probably crush it. They'd do that.
Oh yeah. They're like, bring it.
Let's go. Sure. I can solve this. Oh man. All right. Well, now I understand a little bit more how a label works and like, you know, an artist comes to you guys, like you said, you know, they have a person they talk to and you kind of siphon it off to the other people, the other areas, and everybody kind of gets to work and works together. In our last episode, this is kind of jumping around a little bit, but Melissa talked a little bit about 360 deals or, mm-hmm. you know, deals with labels. And I think we could kind of use this to segue of how labels have changed or pivoted over the past 20 years. What a label was in the early 2000s and prior to that, of course, that's a different story as well. But early 2000s to now, it's a lot different with the internet. And we're not street teaming as much anymore. You know, street teams are probably all online. But first of all, what's a 360 deal? And then furthermore, like, I don't know, can we talk about how deals used to be signed and how they're signed now and how it's kind of changed?
Yeah, that's a really great question. Yeah, I think my personal experience in the industry, you know, coming in, you know, the early 2000s, when I had my first job at a label, this was before any digital. There was no, you know, iTunes was just starting to slowly become a thing.
Yeah.
So, you know, so I feel like I'm in kind of a unique position. I think a lot of my peers too, as well, where it's, you know, we've seen that shift, right? From it just being like a street team, physical, that world, and then transitioning into like, okay, iTunes is a thing. Now Spotify is a thing.
Yeah.
And shifting to digital. And then how labels sort of reacted to that as well. You know, I think the most interesting part about, you know, we say 360 deals, like in the major label, or I'm sure there's indies that do it as well, just essentially means, you know, that we're participating in all areas of an artist's career. And those deals, you know, could all be structured very differently, whether it's, you know, pieces of touring or pieces of merchandise or, you know, if it's, you know, an artist who's also an actor and maybe there's like, you know, participation in a movie or something like that. Yeah. But I think it's just approaching, and I think it's a really healthy thing from the label side, because, you know, you're involved in all aspects of that artist's career. And you're almost approaching it more like, you know, you're able to look at, you know, bigger picture. It's not just like putting a CD in a store. For me, it's been seeing how the merchandise element has played into that from the label side. You know, certainly in my career, it's seeing things like, you know, we call it direct to consumer, D2C, but seeing, you know, how the album pre-order campaign has become such a big thing. Previously, there weren't pre-order cycles. It's not like the album cycle started 2 to 3 months before the record came out. With pre-orders becoming a big thing, that is an area where we get to get so creative and getting to be involved in the merchandise as well. When it's, you know, if we're shooting a video and I'm going, oh, like the singer is wearing like this, how cool would it be if we made that? And then it ends up getting like bundled with the album. And I think it's just an opportunity for us to be so much more involved and give fans such a better experience across the board when it's able to know like, oh, this t-shirt could look like this, you know, build out this box set with all these elements. And it's just, I feel like it's being able to take the album product and just get so much more creative with it. And
because you can do more, you have more reach to more areas.
Yes, definitely. And it gives us also a better understanding of how the different aspects of an artist's career works across the board with, you know, all different angles. So, and it's not like a blanket thing across the industry as well, too. I think that's a misconception as well, that a lot of times major labels, like everyone's a 360 deal or whatever, but everything is, you know, structured kind of differently, just depends on the artist. But yeah, for me as a marketer, it's allowed me to be so much more creative and just offer a much better package across the board for fans. So
yeah, that makes sense. All right. We know what a 360 deal is. We got a good primer over. Like, people sign deals to record labels. Label puts out a record. Can we talk a little bit about the life cycle of that record? Because when we were talking about touring, you know, bands tour an album. An album comes out and they go on tour. And that's kind of what it was to that world. But from a label's world perspective, you already mentioned that, you know, they start with planning a long time before it's hard to do things on purpose. It's easy to do things on accident. It's hard to do things on purpose. It takes a lot of planning.
So
you know,
true.
You got to figure out fonts and colors, and it's a lot. So from conception, inception, oh man, I'm going to mess up the words. From the beginning of when you start working on an album with a band, what's that life cycle like from a pretty zoomed out view? We don't have to get too crazy.
I think so. I love saying that. What is it? Doing things on purpose is hard.
Yeah, so it is. I'm like accidentally successful so much, but to be doing it on purpose, I'm like, oh shit.
It's a lot of work. I mean, from a fan perspective, the people listening have probably noticed that when, you know, your favorite band, you know, starts to tease music or all of their social media suddenly goes dark. And then 2 days later, a tour gets announced. Like you're saying, these things are all, you know, definitely planned out in the marketing timeline life cycle. And that's usually from, you know, the fan facing perspective, you know, the first thing they get seen. But I'm sure you've noticed, obviously, it's, you know, oh, new music is teasing, something's coming. And then it leads to you know, the big announcement and the album goes up for pre-order, the tour gets announced, and then the tickets go on sale.
They're not just making it up as they go, right? They're not like, oh, we released an album, I guess we should book a tour.
Exactly. All part of a plan. And, you know, if it's an artist who, you know, relies heavily on touring, which, you know, a lot of my artists do so much, it's, you know, planning around that and saying, okay, here's our next 2 years. Here's when we're going to be on the road. And just going in and like, I would say it's sort of like Tetris a little bit, because you're like, okay, we're going to have the album done at this time. I'll have the band in LA or whatever to shoot a video here. They go out on tour this date. So a lot of it is that life cycle is lining up how all of these moments connect to each other to make sense, right? And to feel like it's part of, you know, a word we use a lot is era, right? Like it's a new era for this artist, or it could be their first one ever and you want to make it as big as possible. So that's usually when, from a, you know, the fan perspective, you know, that's day one. That's when the lights come up and everything starts. And then we go from there. There's that level of it. And then there's also the sort of more industry, like inside jargon of it all, where it's like, okay, what time are we going to radio with this artist? You know, what song, what's the timing? A lot of times now it's a discussion too of, you know, if we see something that could be reacting, you know, on TikTok, where it's, you know, a song that we never thought would really take off. People are really responding to in an organic way. So then we go in and build out a plan very quickly around that.
Yeah. Like this song's already big. Why push the other song? Why not just, you know, work with what we've got?
I love that so much too. That's so fascinating when you have like a last minute switch, or a song, we call it like raises its hand, right? Like a song is like, hey, check this out. People like this, and sort of reacting to that too. But it's as much as there is a formula and structure to releasing an album and having an album campaign, right? With, you know, the first video will come out this date and then the band will go on tour and then the next video comes out. And then, you know, as much as there is a plan to that, I always say that every day is an adventure in this business, because you could wake up one day and something insane could be happening where you're like, oh, wait, what? Like, oh, okay. And then you get to, you know, again, pivot with the sports analogies, but you get to pivot and build an entirely different, you know, type of campaign. But as much as we have those moments too, which are great, we do have the set sort of traditional plan for how it all works. And that plan is super important, I think, because it sort of defines that time frame for, you know, that artist and that band. And we always like to focus too on giving fans the best experience possible, and knowing that, you know, not every fan will be able to get the like $200 crazy vinyl box set. And also knowing, like, you know, fans are going to want to, you know, spend their hard earned money on like concert tickets, and then also this merch, and like how that staggers out for people in a fair way as well. So there is a lot that goes into that, but generally I would say the life cycle, which is what we call like an album cycle campaign, is usually that moment from everything being announced, being teased, you know, band goes on tour. Maybe there's like 3 to 4 videos over the course of, you know, a year and a half, 2 years. And then we call it going into A&R mode, when, you know, when an artist goes back into the studio and starts working on new music, because those are usually the times when, I'm sure you notice, like things kind of like quiet down a bit.
Settle down. Yeah.
Yeah. Because the band is in the studio, they're writing, or they're taking time off, you know, and trying to going into what that next world is. So that's usually what we call, like, if somebody's like off cycle, is when they're either taking time off, or they're, which for the artist, it's not off cycle, obviously, because they're working really hard making music. But from the label side, we're sort of like sitting and waiting, and A&R is doing their thing and they're creating.
Okay. That makes sense. It's so, like, I always try to think back to, you know, before I worked in the music industry and I was just a fan, or I was street teaming, and how it looked like when you say from the fan's perspective, because it's so easy when you live and breathe it to forget. You know, I think back to when I walked in a venue, I didn't know anything did. And I try to think of the same kind of a parallel when I just listened to music. I was like, oh, the album's out. Oh, listen to the music. Oh, they're going on tour. I should get a ticket. And it's so cool to hear about the inner workings of the back end of it and the intention of the people working on it, because I don't know, we've all experienced the hard work and the outcome of it, but it's cool to know what goes into that. So I appreciate you kind of laying it out.
Of course, too. And it's not just labels as well. It's us working with, you know, the agents and the managers. And there's so many different teams that go into it, which your podcast is so great that you explore all these different worlds.
We're trying.
But it's a big, you know, it's a lot of people working together to come up with a plan that we feel like is the most exciting, cool, unique, effective plan possible. So,
well, thank you as a fan.
Yes. Oh, hey, of course.
All right. You've got to help me out. What the hell is with all the different... Okay, a subsidiary I know is like you've got Atlantic and then there's some labels underneath and they've got other names, but everything seems to be connected and really there's like three labels or something. What can you just explain to me what's going on there without making me feel too stupid?
I wish I would have come with a PowerPoint. This is such a great,
with a
such
pointer?
A great chance for a PowerPoint. I talk with my hands a lot. I'm sure you've noticed, but so for the majors, obviously there's like the big major companies, right? You know, Warner Music Group, which is the, you know, the company that I work for is underneath. And you just think of them as like, you know, the big overarching umbrellas. And then there's this offshoot, and then there's labels underneath that. And then it's just the way it's structured. Like if it was like an org chart, I guess.
I was trying to think of what they're called, company, org charts. Yeah.
Yeah. Main companies and then how it all breaks down. And, you know, I'm sure you've probably seen in the news a lot of times too. It's, you know, major labels will, you know, invest in or acquire different companies. And then those companies get, you know, put into different parts of, you know, other systems. And so it's basically one giant company with a bunch of different companies in it that all make up that larger company. But within those smaller companies, there's, you know, we have our own staffs, our own teams, everyone's got very different rosters, and like the culture and DNA of those companies could feel very different, even though we're all in the same building. But yeah, I guess it's like thinking of like a high school, but you have all the different grades.
But you all go to school together, and they each of them has their own like branding and click and like vibe they're giving off. So for example, you know, Death Row Records is going to put out a different album than Fueled by Ramen. And you're going to know that just by their name, right? One of them sounds like woohoo, and the other one has Death Row in it. So, you know, it's very, yeah.
But those different labels could all be part of the same overarching company. And I think that's what makes it the major system set up so interesting, is that there are so many different, you know, so many different genres and so many different companies, so many different label brands that can all make up one bigger label brand.
You guys are all the cool labels now. You're all the cool ones. I was looking at your list. I was like, oh, all the cool labels are Electra now. Cause I didn't realize Fueled By was on.
Awesome.
When did you guys acquire Fueled By Ramen?
I'm trying to think how I can answer that. Fueled By Ramen became part of the Atlantic system back when I was originally there.
Oh yeah, long time ago.
And then 3 years ago when the Electra Music Group started, it encompassed, you know, it's Fueled By Ramen, Roadrunner, GTA Records, and so all the other
Johnny Minardi Inc. That's how I think of it.
Exactly. We're all just here with Johnny.
Yeah.
Shout out to Johnny. He's listening.
Yeah. Johnny's
you gotta have him on too. Is he next?
I know. I need to hit him up. Is it weird? It's like a really interesting level of like, I want to be appropriate with my friend groups and like I don't want to punish somebody. So I don't want to put them in the position where they have to say yes. And let them know like, hey, I just want you to do this if you want to do this. And I'm not
totally
offended
yeah.
if you don't want to do this. And I haven't gotten up the courage. I've known Johnny for a really long time and I haven't gotten the courage to ask him yet. So maybe he'll just listen to this and hit me up.
Yeah.
Hey, Johnny.
I work with Johnny on a lot of projects and he is such a talented A&R and so passionate and just a really good person and so fun to work with. Like we have a lot of fun together. That's the thing too. You can't take this business too seriously because then
eat you alive.
It will eat you alive. You got to be able to laugh and have fun about what we're doing, which is a good approach to have.
Yeah, no, I agree. Johnny is definitely a somebody I look up to very, very much. And I'm glad to know like anybody who works in your guys' group and circle, I'm happy to talk to because I feel like I've just been going through your friends recently. Like it's all these people on here and just everybody from the good corner. There's a lot of good. That sounds like there's bad corners. That's not what I mean. You guys are just exceptionally great.
Yes. We're very grateful to get to work with some really awesome humans who, you know, outside of work too, those are friends, you know?
Yeah.
And so that's really cool. I feel like that's something that in other industries doesn't really happen where it's like, yeah, we work together all day long, but then we all want to hang out because we're friends and we all geek out about music. And at the end of the day, I feel like we all started at the same place too. Like we all started in sweaty basements singing along and at Knights of Columbus Halls and, you know,
yeah.
So like we all came from that
teen
place.
Centers.
Yeah. Teen centers, roller skating rinks.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Fast forward Madison, Wisconsin. I saw the Norma Jean there. I was like, what is going on here? Anyway,
awesome.
That just brought back a memory. Okay. Yeah. You get to work with your friends and that can be, I mean, it's there's advantages to that and it can be confusing, right? You know, hey,
totally,
we disagree with something professionally, but we're still friends. But you know, that kind of leads us into arguably one of the most important parts of working in this industry. And that's kind of your work-life balance and how you, I don't know, how you structure everything. So for you, how do you make sure that, I don't know, you don't work too much? Is that a thing? Or like, what's your, I know you got a Peloton, so.
I have a
Hashtag not sponsored. You guys have to pay us to not mention your name. Yeah.
Come at me, Peloton. Yeah, it's, I think that is one of the lessons that took me the longest to learn in this business, because I have, you know, as much, you know, success and everything else and passion, I've also really had moments where I've been, you know, burnt out. And when I've really needed a break, or if, you know, I've asked myself before, like, do I want to keep doing this? Do I want to explore something else? And I think something I always tell people who are just starting out too, is that those are such important moments. And also it's okay to hit pause and take a break. I think in this industry, a lot of times we feel like we have to be on 24/7 going, otherwise we're going to miss something or something's going to pass us by, or we won't get, you know, the sort of fear of missing out. But that's what's taken me the longest to learn, is that it's okay to pause and take a break. And I feel like over the past couple of years, absolutely with, you know, quarantine and shutdown and live music going away and, you know, everyone's entire world getting pulled up, is the focus on, you know, are you okay? Like, check in with everyone you work with and, you know, normalize hitting pause for a minute, which I think is something that we're all, at the end of the day, taking care of yourself. If I am not good, nothing else will be good, you know? So I think there's a big focus on that too, but yeah, it's just that balance. And as much as our industry focuses on, you know, like the hustle and, you know, I talk about networks and building relationships, but part of that is also knowing, like, it's cool to not be at everything too.
Yeah.
It's cool to like shut down your computer at a certain time every night and know like, hey, it's time for me to shut down. You know, me personally, I'm a mom, and that to me was like the biggest, because once you know, parenthood comes into your life, you are not in control of your own schedule ever anymore. And, you know, things like
chaos ensues,
late nights at shows and traveling and festivals, that all becomes very different. So I think that's been a big lesson for me in learning that like, it's okay. And also, you know, you can go focus on another area of your life, whatever that is. If it's, you know, a hobby, parenting, go for a hike, whatever, but like, it's okay to hit pause and take a break. It'll all still be there when you get back.
Yes. Unless COVID happens, then there will be no,
then it's something
no
else
more concerts when again. No. Yeah, no, that's I think that's a great lesson. And I know you said it took you the longest to learn. And I think I can agree with that. And I would also say that it's something that, I mean, I'm sure you can agree too, we're all still learning a balance. Yes. And as life changes and as you think you got it all figured out, then it's like, but what about this? Did you think about this yet? And you're like, oh, okay. Yeah, I got to figure out that now too.
I feel like it's the first time in our industry, at least since I've been in it, and I think it's such a, you know, bright spot in what's happened over the past few years, is that we prioritize mental health a lot more. And we make sure we say, hey, how are you doing? Or how can I help? Or do you need to talk? Like, things that didn't always happen. You know, I think in the past it was sort of, you know, you want it to be like seen as like Teflon and like, I can do anything, but like, you know, it's okay to not be okay, or whatever that saying is.
Yeah. You know what really helped me humanize the people I speak to? And this might be a reflection of my inability to humanize somebody, or it could be, you know, maybe I am the average, but I just FaceTiming with people like yourself or anybody and like seeing their child run around in the back, or being like, oh, nice, our couches look similar, or it's just stuff where I'm like, oh, you're not in an office or at a concert where I'm kind of intimidated by you. It's nice to like see somebody see parts of yourself and understand like, oh, they probably make dinner too. They're not just like crazy.
That is such a positive spot too. And like, say my daughter has run in, like I've been on Zoom with an artist who's playing new music for the first time, and she'll like run in naked and be like, go be crazy.
Your music does this.
Right. It's also allowed her to like, she gets to see what I do. Like, she'll come in and I'll be like looking at album art. I'll be like, oh, I just got the new Jane video in. Do you want to watch it? And she'll like run in and watch the video edit with me. And
oh, that's awesome.
This year, the albums that I put out this year, too, I remember specifically when A Day to Remember, You're Welcome came out in March. Yeah. That was one of the first records that like post shutdown and everything was in, you know, it was in all physical retails and Target, and we could actually go into the store and buy it. So that was a really cool moment, getting to take her into Target and be like, look, there's that thing you've seen on my computer for the past year.
It's real, Mom.
Exactly. I'm like, look, see?
You really did it.
Yeah. And then she's like, what's cool. a CD? Which is another discussion, but...
Has she been to a concert yet?
She has been to...
I don't know how old she is, so maybe she was
prior
COVID.
She just turned six. Yeah, she just turned six.
Okay, so yeah.
Yeah, she's been to stuff. She thinks it's really cool to get to wear headphones. That's her favorite part. She's like, yes, I get to wear the headphones. But she has been to a few shows. Yeah, now that she's getting older and can kind of stay up later, she hasn't seen 21 Pilots yet, though, so I'm very excited to take her to her first 21 Pilots show.
Ruin every other live concert that exists. I got to save that for the end. Be like, everything's pretty cool. 21 right? Pilots.
I always think about that, too, that, like, what an interesting way to grow up. Like, she is going to be so, like, she's not going to care about music at all, probably. Or maybe she will.
Yeah.
But, like, you know, my way of, like, growing up in the South, it's like, I don't think I went to my first concert until I was well into high school.
Yeah, right. Until you could afford the ticket that your parent convinced your parents to let you stay out that late. It was not happening.
Yes. And she's come to, like, I'll bring her to, you know, to video shoots, or, you know, I have so many photos of her, like, strapped onto me as a baby, like, at work and stuff.
So, oh, that's cool.
It's pretty awesome.
I love that. All right, sweet. I think the last thing we should talk about is, you know, what can people do who maybe start listening to the podcast because they want a tour and they found out they don't want a tour, or they're just looking for, I think labels provide a good first step into the industry because they have such a variety of jobs that exist in all different strengths and levels. What do you think somebody can do, or what can somebody do to, you know, get their foot in or start working at a label or something like that?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I think it's always, you know, labels do provide, because it is very different from something that's in the touring world where, you know, you're home, right? And you have a job that's, you know, at the end of the day is, you know, while it's not really a 9-to-5 Monday through Friday type job, because we are on a lot off hours, but, you know, but you are, you know, part of a company and it's a steady paycheck and there's benefits. So it's definitely, I understand, you know, that versus like the touring world. But yeah, I think it just all goes back to what we started talking about too, with, you know, with relationships and with, you know, just do your research and really explore and define, okay, I want to work at a label. Now, how do I get there? And I know, like, without label, cause I would say internships are a great way to get in. I know that's changed a little bit during COVID, but, you know, my advice would be just to get in any way that, you know, any way, anything you want to learn about, whether it is like, there's so many great organizations that have just do like Zoom chats like this, where you could tune in and just learn and, you know, listen to podcasts and research and just figure out, you know, okay, who do I know? How can I get in? Or even if it is like, you know, blind applying for jobs too, like that works as well. But yeah, I think it's just, it all comes down to relationships and hard work and, you know, people knowing and remembering you and knowing, oh, that's, you know, one of the jobs I had at Victory when I was an intern, I always love telling the story. It was in Chicago. In the dead of winter, at the time we had, I don't know if you remember the big like street team vans that were like wrapped with the Victory logo. But I remember one of my jobs as an intern was like cleaning out those vans in like negative 20 degree weather. And like, but I was so excited. I was just like, absolutely, I'm in, like, let's go. I would just say it's going to take hard work to get in. And like you said, doing things on purpose is hard. But yeah, it's going to take hard work and building those relationships and do what you can do. Ask to go like, hey, is it cool if I go to the show? Hey, is it cool? Like, just really make the effort to get to know the people that you're working with once you're in there. And yeah, just do what you can to learn and keep your eyes open, and opportunities truly are everywhere. And sometimes they might look a little different than you thought they would. And that's cool too. Like sometimes you get into different things in different ways. So, but yes, I always think about like cleaning out the street, like vacuuming French fries out of a street team van at like negative 20 degree weather. But I was so happy to do it. I was like, this is awesome.
Okay, cool. Well, I mean, hopefully that'll give our listeners something to take home, and I know we've said it a lot on this podcast, but it's nice hearing it from everybody who comes on, that you just got to find out what works for you in your area. I think that pretty much sums it up, Katie. Like, that was a pretty good, I thought it was a good Label 101 episode, if my opinion counts or anything.
Of course. Thank you. And this has been super fun, and yeah, anything I can help with, let me know. But yeah, talking about record labels is something I love doing, and I can nerd out about it we can keep going for hours probably.
All right, cool. Well, we'll have you back to talk more about your job in specific, hopefully in the future. And awesome. If not, I'll come to you for some guidance on, you know, maybe who else we should have on here, what other jobs we should cover, because I've never worked at a label. I've worked on tour, not at a label. So I got a lot to learn myself. Okay. One last question that we do ask everybody, even though you've never toured, we need to know if you were to tour have you toured? I'm assuming that.
I have not ever toured. I've obviously been to like
a show,
shows and festivals. And one of my favorite things to do is to go to shows, because a lot of times we get stuck in like New York or LA mentality. I love going to shows not in New York or LA.
Oh yeah, that is nice because you just get to hang out and watch. Shower shoes, no shower shoes. Do you know about what shower shoes are? It's like what people wear when they shower. Sometimes people are like, I wear shower shoes because I think it's gross. So they're like, no, I don't wear shower shoes. It's a shower. What do you think? Do you think you'd wear them or not? It's probably a shower you're sharing with a bunch of people.
I would definitely wear shower shoes if I were on tour.
Okay,
absolutely.
Cool. I just had to know. I needed to be able to judge you. So
of course. No, I'm just kidding. I mean, is that I can only imagine the life of that's something I have never thought of before from the label side. We never have to think about.
Thanks for coming to the show tonight. Would you like to shower? Yeah.
That is really fun. I would wear the shower shoes.
All right, cool. And on that note, thank you so much for your time, Katie. Well, we'll see you on here again, I'm sure.
Of course, yeah. Thank you, Adam. This has been great.